Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming on this rainy day. I'm Andrea Sato, and I work on adult programs at Wilton Library, and we're happy to partner again with SPED NET. Before I turn it over to Eve Kessler to introduce our speakers, I want to let you know about a few of our upcoming programs. Next Wednesday, March 6th, we have an author talk, Patrick Bringley, who worked as a museum guard at the Metropolitan Museum of Art for 10 years, and he wrote a memoir called All the Beauty in the World. It should be very interesting. Thursday following that, the League of Women Voters will present information on how early voting will work in Connecticut for the spring's primary and general election in November, because that's new. And the following week, if you know any high school girls or any young people looking, young women looking for a career in technology, we have a great panel of people, women from ASML, to talk about careers in technology. So let your friends know if they have girls in high school particularly. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Eve.
Thanks for coming, everyone.
He wants you to ask people who have come.
If you guys want to move up a little so you can hear better and whatever, that would be great. Thanks.
Is that better?
Oh, much better. Much more interesting.
Thanks very much. For those of you who aren't familiar with SPEDNET or aren't on our emailing list, please make sure to sign in the back so you're sure to get a copy of the presentation, copies of all our videotapes of all our presentations. We're happy to be co-sponsoring this with Wilton Public Schools and Newtown PTA. If anybody is here from Newtown, Mary Murphy is here, and there is a study room for you guys afterwards if you want to discuss the presentation further. Marcia Eckerd is a licensed psychologist with over 35 years of experience as a therapist and consultant working with neurodivergent children and adults. She's published 3 articles on autism in the peer-reviewed journal of Health Services Psychology. Her article on diagnosing previously unrecognized autistic women is read internationally. Her Psychology Today blog, Are We Giving Autistic Children PTSD from School, has had over 259,000 reads and led her to writing a book with Robert Bernstein on how neurodivergent children are treated in school, which then has led to this talk. Robert Bernstein, an educational and behavioral therapist, has been working with neurodivergent children and particularly those on the autism spectrum for more than 35 years. His book, Uniquely Normal, Tapping the Reservoir of Normalcy to Treat Autism, won 6 awards for psychology, parenting, autism, and mental health. His newest book is Uniquely Normal Manual. He has personal experience with autism, having grown up with an autistic brother and is the father of an autistic son. Marcia and Rob's YouTube channel is called Everything Neurodiversity. Please turn off your cell phones and we'll get going.
Can you hear me? Okay, good. Thank you, Eve. And if anybody isn't familiar with SPEDNET, one of the things they have is absolutely wonderful is they have a video archive of all the talks they've had on their website. So, and there's, it covers just about everything, wouldn't you say, Eve? So there's just enormous resource of information. You can go to as many conference talks as you could possibly tolerate, and it's all on there.
And it's all free.
And it's all free, okay? You don't have to pay. So what we're talking about today, excuse me, is school interventions for kids who are wired differently. And as you said, we both primarily work with kids on the spectrum, but kids who have ADHD, kids who have nonverbal learning disabilities, there's a lot of kids whose brains are wired differently. And actually, a lot of these ideas apply to all kids. So I should put up this Anything you want to say before we start?
No, just thanks for coming. And I've met a few of you, and I wish I could give a talk on each one of your kids that I've spoken with.
So that's, yeah, he that's would. If I don't, we have a talk we're doing. So, wait a minute, I have to do this.
Good.
Okay.
School is the one thing that, though I don't dream very often, if I have some sort of reoccurring nightmare, it is likely to be about school. And unfortunately, a lot of autistic and neurodivergent people share these similar sentiments about education.
That's why we're doing this, because so many neurodivergent kids and so many parents are struggling to kind of represent their kids in school meetings, or the kids are sort of struggling dealing with how they're treated in school. And this is a lyric, and this is kind of how she feels. And the blog that I wrote now has over 260,000 reads, and you know, people just keep coming to me saying, this is my life, this is my kid, this is what we're doing. And what we want to do is to try to help people understand and bring that understanding both to the kids but also to the school.
So here's an adult. Her thing is neurodivergent rebel. She posts like every day.
Her
lyric, yeah. But I should mention that she deserves it. And but here's an adult talking about the most traumatic experience of her life was in school, right? So we want to take the kids who are in school now who are being, and traumatized is not an understatement. You know, this it is, and some of you are shaking your heads. So we want to take the kids who are in school now and do something,
right,
to change them being traumatized. So that's kind of what's happening.
Right. I mean, when we think of trauma, you might think of you're in a car accident or something like that. But trauma can also be kind of millions of little cuts, you know, just over and over, day by day, messages that, you know, you're not okay, you're bad, you're doing the wrong thing. Why can't you be different? Why can't you just stop? And so that's kind of what we're calling, the kids come out of it with scars. And as you'll see, there are adults like Lyric and Steph, who you'll meet later, with the scars of this internalized sense of themselves as, I'm not okay enough, all right? And that's what we want to ideally prevent. So what do we mean by neurodiversity? Is everybody familiar with the idea of neurodiversity? Yeah? Okay, good. Then we'll do this quickly. Neurodiversity is a different way of processing. Okay, it's a different way of experiencing the world. And so if you have a different way of experiencing the world, you have a different way of responding to the world.
So who's neurodivergent? All right, Bill Gates is supposed to be, well, I say supposed to be because it's not official, but everyone knows it. He's on the spectrum. So is my mic on? My mic keeps on going off.
It's on. Yeah, I mean, not only Bill Gates, but I mean, whether we like X or Twitter or whatever it is or not, Elon Musk is openly autistic, okay? The guy can talk. The guy doesn't look like what they think autistic looks like. Sir Anthony Hopkins is autistic. You know, the idea of what autistic looks like is not up to speed with what autistic people look like. And so these are some of the things that would come under the idea of neurodivergent. But so much of what we're dealing with is that I had this one girl, she's very literal, okay? And she thought she might be on the spectrum, and she told her psychiatrist, she comes in to see me, and she said, well, can you see autism? And I said, well, no, you know, it's your experience on the inside. She said, well, my psychiatrist said, I don't see it, that you're autistic. And she thought he meant literally, you know, there'd be a halo around you that said autism on it. And I said, no, no, he means it doesn't make sense to him. You want to say that? Okay.
I love this slide. And I hope you could hear me because my mic just went out.
It's on.
It's, yeah, I'm a cat. I'm not a defective dog. I mean, I want to be who I am. Where's the authenticity of who these kids, who our kids are?
Yeah, by definition, according to the traditional view of autism, and unfortunately it's the traditional view that most schools have been trained in, and most experts have been trained in, is that autism, NLD, all these things are just pathology. You know, we look at it in terms of what can't they do, and not what can they do. And we don't look at the person as a whole person. In some ways, we look at them as a diminished person, all right? And what we're seeing is if you are on the spectrum or if you have some kind of difference in your neurotype, in yourself, that doesn't make you a diminished human being, all right? And that the, what I tell kids or young adults when I work with them is you're not a broken PC, you're a Mac. You have a different operating system. You know, Word works differently on PCs and Macs, but you know, you're a perfectly fine computer. And so our kids are perfectly fine people. So let me tell you a story about this. So if I go into a school or I'm talking to, they'll say, oh, we know about autism, and they can list off the autistic traits, okay? And so among the autistic traits are difficulty transitioning, right? Or are, you know, a lot of kids have slow motor speed, or maybe slow processing speed. They, you know, all of these things I'll tell you is a list. But I have this little guy, and he is, he was late, he's in middle school, he was late to math class every day, you know, 5-6 minutes late. And the teacher told the parents that he was not respectful. He was disrespectful of her. He had a bad attitude. He didn't take math seriously. Well, what happened is this kid was neurodivergent. He had gym class before. So we had to get changed. And he's a slow buttoner. And he's slow at getting dressed. And he had to kind of get all of his stuff together and figure out what he needed and make it to math class. It took him longer. He was the most caring, responsible kid in the world, and the fact that his teacher was saying, the teacher's always mad at me, okay? Because nobody was understanding that these are the traits, but this is what it looks like, you know? And that's what we're all
so
about.
I just a story of a girl. I'm there in the class. When I visit a school, I'm there all day long. So I'm there in the class, and she's late, because she has to pack up, like Marcia's saying, to her art class, and I'm there with her, and she misses the first couple of minutes where the teacher is explaining what the art project is for the day. I had to wait to the very end and ask the teacher, what was the point of this lesson? And it was like potato, you know, but it was the idea, it was some fancy word that when you stamp a potato ink on something, half of it goes off the page. There's some artistic word for that. But I had no idea that was the idea of the lesson. So the kid comes in late, sits in the back of the class. So if there's just an awareness, a respect, if you want to call it that, the teacher could have one of the other kids, oh, you know, so-and-so is a couple of minutes late, have another kid explain the idea to this kid.
Right.
The teacher, I mean, like, so this idea of being late, not only is the teacher mad at me, but then she kind of misses the idea of the next lesson, which I didn't know there was an idea until the end.
Right.
They say, wait, we're missing. Yeah, so it's a global issue, a systemic issue.
And of course that thing gets reflected in the grade for art, right? Because she didn't do it right. So what are the ideas that we think are harmful?
So I know you guys know who Skinner is, the Skinner box, right? You've had that, but I need to talk about this because the behavioral approach is the standard approach. And there are reasons for that, ABA and so forth. And Skinner, I think he was a graduate student at Harvard. He just did the Skinner box. And the Skinner box has a, and this is, people don't realize this. Okay, we know about the reinforcement. The rat is pressing the lever and is getting a pellet. And the pellet is a reinforcer that increases the behavior of the rat, right? We all know that, pressing the lever. But there's also a grid for punishment, an electric grid. So the behavioral model is reward-punishment system.
And you'll get told that, well, we don't punish. Okay, what we'll do is ignore. okay, if there's a behavior we don't like, we'll ignore it or something like that. Ignoring is punishment, right? It's a lack of positive regard. I mean, if people are ignoring you, don't you feel it? You know, don't you feel bad if people are visibly ignoring you? So that is a disincentive. But we're not saying every behavioral technique is bad. For example, I had one kid who was in, I think he was in middle school, and he would get incredibly frustrated, and then he'd start yelling at, you know, the other kids. So I taught him breathing techniques, okay? I taught him how to slow down his breath, how to calm down. His parents did it every day with him, and bless them, they said, look, we all need this as a life skill, so they did it too, which said, you're not a broken kid. This is something we can all do. And we worked out a system where green meant he was cool, yellow meant he was starting to get upset, and red meant boom. And so the teachers would use this. So in gym class, you know, he was getting bumped and he was starting to get upset. The teacher would say, hey, Brian, you're not looking green anymore. You're getting yellow. And Brian knew that meant he could go across, do his breathing, and come back. All right? That's behavioral, okay? But it's organic to the kid. It's not rote learning. It's not just do what I say because I say so and you'll get an M&M. It's he had a need. He learned a skill that helped him deal with his need.
I'm so glad you said that. It's not rote learning. And a lot of education is rote, counting to 100. You know, that gets taught, the ABCs, counting to 100. But does the kid understand the concept of counting? There's a concept. You know, like three is one more than two. I mean, as you're counting, right? But that concept is never not taught. It's not often taught.
Right.
So why have that checkbox? My kid, the goal is, you know, this child will, the IEP, this child will count to 15. And I'm saying, wait a second. That may be doing more harm than good if the idea behind it is lost.
Yeah, I remember way back when my daughter was little and she's 40 now, they had this thing called Einstein cards and people would use them with little kids to kind of teach them. Do they really understand it? Was it meaningful to them? No, but they could remember a lot. And what we object to is when you have rote learning, like you will exhibit these behaviors and get a check, or you will exhibit these behaviors and make me happy, and the kid learns to exhibit these behaviors, but they're not coming from inside. They're not coming from what the child wants or what the child is understanding or trying to do. So let me just go on. So I'm not going to read this. So this is what a functional behavioral approach looks like in school. You know, we define what the behavior is and we reinforce the behavior. And, you know, if the kid, and most kids do want that positive feedback. So often they will do that behavior. Some won't, but a lot do. But what they're looking is, you know, this is what's expected of me. All right. And one of the problems is we're teaching kids, don't think about how you feel. Don't think about yourself. Think about what other people want you to do and say yes. And there comes a point in time in life when, take for a girl, it's not good to say yes to everything. All right? But that distinction isn't made.
And when kids get older, you'll hear them say, they won't answer a question because they want to tell you what you want to hear. So that's how they're trained. They learn to do that.
Right. And so when an intervention isn't working, it's blamed on the kid. He's not compliant. All right. Well, if you start out with where the child is at, then you're more likely to get a successful intervention. So instead of blaming the kid, we were saying, hey, let's take this back. Maybe it's not working because it's not addressing what needs to be addressed. And so one very common thing that we run into all the time is kids are choosing to be difficult. Okay, you're not doing your work because you're avoidant, you're oppositional, you're rude, you have a bad attitude. You could choose to have a better attitude. You could choose to be, you know, polite.
Right, and I was talking to one of the parents here. The kid has a behavioral problem, but he's a nice kid. He's not having a behavioral problem because he's doing it purposely. He's not a malicious kid. And here's the problem with neurodivergency, and that is it's invisible, right? If a kid's in a wheelchair, okay, we get it. Now, we're asking all the kids to walk up front. He's in a wheelchair. We understand it. But how about the neurodivergent kid? that's overwhelmed by something going on in the classroom. Now he's being oppositional.
Right. And so the basic message when you see it as choiceful is that often you see it as manipulative. Often you see it as called attention-seeking, avoidant, all this kind of stuff. And I had a girl who was in, she was in high school, and the way she self-calmed was by drawing, okay? And she had an iPad, and she would draw on the iPad. She'd go into Spanish, and she'd pull out her iPad. So there was a behavior plan, you know, one prompt, you give in your iPad, you know, you give in the iPad, you don't draw, or you give it in with one prompt, that kind of thing. Okay, so the girl starts crying, and the teacher says, she puts her head down on the desk, the teacher said, well, if you're tired, you can go to the nurse, which the girl felt totally humiliated. Nobody asked her why she was drawing. The assumption was she was drawing because she didn't care about Spanish. Actually, it was an incredibly noisy classroom. They're very rowdy boys, they made tons of noise, and she was just overwhelmed because she was very auditorily sensitive. Okay, so this really made it hard for her to be there. And also there were a lot of sort of social things. You know, I think of social as an interaction. I'm going to talk to you and you're going to talk to me. Social is everything. Okay, so if there are kids in the classroom who are rolling their eyes, that's social. So if she was talking to some boys and they would kind of do very subtle things or making fun of her, that was also very difficult for her. So her way of tolerating being in that space was to draw. And when they took away the iPad, they were taking away her way of being able to function in that space. So this is what these kids get called. And you want to say it?
Well, I like this slide because where the goals are often to have all the kids look alike. And teachers will tell me, well, he comes in and he's not like the other kids. What am I supposed to do? I say, well, look, you know, it goes to a philosophy. I'm writing an article on John Dewey now. It goes to the philosophy of education, that there's, what happened to individuality? Why do you need to conform? I mean, Dewey says conformity leads to being unethical. He really, you know, extends it to ethics, that it's just not a right way of treating an individual. So,
we all know about groupthink. For example, and that's not what we want. And it is called an individual education plan, right? There is the word individual in there somewhere. So, and you know, and this is sort of the point we're making over and over till you get sick of us, which is whether it's you understanding what your child is doing, whether it's you understanding what your child is doing, whether it's the teacher understanding what your child is doing, or the child understanding herself or himself or themselves or whatever pronoun. You know, as they go out into life, so many, I diagnose undiagnosed women, as you said, and so many of them come through life with just a sense of failure and shame that everybody else does something that I can't do, or why is it so hard for me? And they might even realize that they have auditory sensitivity because, as far as they know, everybody hears the same thing. Everybody else is just able to handle it better. So it's important.
I didn't want to interrupt. I just want to say something. Oh, 1 second. About the IEP, right? That's universal. It's universal because it's a federal law. Every kid has to have it. When that came out in 1975, I was so excited. Finally, an individualized program. That's exactly what we're talking about here. Every kid. I was so excited. I taught the law. 94-142, you could look it up, the law when it came out in 1975. And then years later, this parent comes in, shows me the IEP, and I look at it, I go, oh wait, that's not your kid's name. In other words, the find and replace function didn't quite work, and it's the same thing for whatever, 4 or 5 kids in the class. And I'm going, oh boy, the idea was there, and we just screwed that up.
Kids have individual education plans, and how many of you have individual education plans that are carried out?
Yeah, I mean, and to be fair, you know, I'll talk to a teacher and she'll say, I have 30 kids in my class and 14 of them have individual education plans. And there is no way I can do it. So there's a system set up that actually defeats the whole purpose. Yeah.
Then you have you have 15 on IEPs. That's a whole nother level of what they've been trained to do. Right. And when I taught 20 some odd years ago and had my own classroom, I did a lot of small group work. The kids didn't have IEPs, but this is something that teachers are not trained to do. And this is a whole other conversation is how much the education system is broken. But yeah. It makes it very difficult to work with the children that are having the problems and realizing what the root of the problem is. Like you said, that the girl, the class was so noisy that she needed to color to be, and I get that, but for the Spanish teacher to realize that's what she needs is something that the Spanish teacher is not trained in.
And that's why part of our book is called Radical Change, because you're right. As the system is right now, it's not possible to do some of the things we're talking about. And what that means is the system needs to change. You know, whether it's working in small groups or having more people or, you know, we've got to, everyone says, oh, children are so important. But we all know that, you know, when it comes to funding, when it comes to other things, that's not always the case. And so the fundamental system has to change if these kids are going to grow up to feel positive about themselves and capable of what their potential is, and all that kind of stuff. We have to have ways of making this work. And also, I think, and you can tell me if you think I'm wrong, I think teachers are also trained that classroom management's really important. So if you have a kid doing something different and you sort of turn, you don't pay attention to it, then everybody's going to want to do something different. And then you're going to have chaos. And so this fear of chaos is sort of taught to the teachers as opposed to the idea that, hey, people in here can do what they need, but we're still going to be able to maintain what we're doing. And yeah, unless, as you said, you have kids working in small groups or you have a different system so that Or teachers are trained. So we're talking about, you know, fundamental change in how people are trained, how people are thinking, you know, so that we're not blaming.
I'll tell you what I told the teacher a couple of weeks ago. This kid, when he moves, he could actually pay more attention when he's moving. And the teacher, well, if I allow him to stand up and move, then everyone's, right? Everyone's going to, I can't have that. So now you're restricting the kid to conform and all hell breaks loose. We have a slide on this? Okay, don't forget, I'm gonna tell you the story later. It's a great story. This one?
Scared of these things. My response was, everybody has different needs, and when you need something, you will get it. And you know what? Most of the kids were like, okay.
Okay, you're forcing me to finish the story. Oh. And that is, so I told the teacher, okay, this kid functions well. He's in the side of the room. He's not interrupting the lesson. And the way you could explain it to every kid, it says, oh, you're sitting up front because you do better up front, you know, and that kid's sitting in the back because it's less stressful for him, and you have glasses, and you, right? And the idea, just what Marcia said, that everyone has different needs, and I challenge, you know, the teacher with 30 kids, and they have, and that's the idea of special education, right, to give kids what they need individual. That is the law, right? So that's the challenge. If that's impossible, then let's see if the teachers could do the impossible.
Right.
Yeah, and that's why we're saying, you know, we can't blame teachers, and but they're in a system where they're not allowed to say, I don't know. You know, they're not allowed to say, I'm not trained in this. They're supposed to be the professional who knows everything, and they're under pressure to say, well, we know what we're doing, and, you know, as opposed to let's bring in somebody because we don't know what we're doing.
And there are in-service, they have, every school has in-service training. That's usually the most boring thing to teachers. They should have people coming in, right, and giving this kind of training. Whatever they do, every month, they have in-service training.
But we are agreeing, though, that for one teacher with a group of 30 to do this for every kid is not going to work. We're talking about fundamental change here. So just briefly, and this is probably something you all know, but the idea is that the top of the iceberg is the behavior, and we see the behavior, and the behavior is labeled avoidant. Okay, the kids, that girl, she wasn't doing her Spanish, so she was avoidant, right? She's getting the attention of the teacher, so she's attention-seeking. No, from her perspective, she's not attention-seeking. From the perspective of somebody who's giving her attention, she's attention-seeking. She's rude. She's like, so we get the behavior and some interpretation of an outsider of the behavior at the top. But then we respond to the behavior as we did to her. You know, we're going to get rid of this behavior that's disruptive or that's avoidant or that's attention-seeking or whatever. But if you go under the water, that's where the action is. And the action is, you know, what is going on for that child that is causing that behavior? And too often, when you have a kid who's, say, melting down or a kid who's not doing something, the tendency is to say, oh, it's because they're autistic, right? The label is blamed for the behavior instead of, hey, this is a kid, a regular person, and there's something going on here. And then the bottom is that this kind of experience of what's going on for me isn't recognized and I'm getting in trouble or somebody's speaking to me and I can tell that they're pissed is stress. How many of you have kids who are stressed? Yeah, anybody? How many of you are stressed? Right? And so the next slide is that we all know the stress response. The stress response is a physiological response. It's not just a psychological response. So when you get stress hormones going through your body, nobody ever calmed down by someone saying, just calm down, right? Because they're physiologically stressed. And that causes, and somebody who's stressed over and over and over has something they call the pathological stress response, which means, you know, if you're sort of baseline, you're not too stressed, which isn't true of any of us, but we'll leave that aside. And, you know, something happens, the car in front of you jams on the brake, your stress goes up, but then it comes back down. And it goes up and comes back down. A pathological stress response where things keep happening all day in the class, in the hall, in the recess, is the stress goes up, but it doesn't come all the way down. And then it goes up and it doesn't come down there. And so what we're doing is we're looking at something like that, where you have a kid who's pretty much stressed or anxious all the time. And here's an important thing, which is if you look at the low end of the y-axis, I never get them straight, the x-axis, you'll see that if you're not revved up enough, you're going to do a lousy job. You know, if you listen to a sports team, they'll say, we left it all on the field, right? That means we were psyched. We did everything we could. If you're going to do an art project, you know, you want to give it your all. You want to really be into it. So if you're not interested, you don't perform well. And there's a sweet spot of being sort of psyched and aroused where you do well. But look what happens to performance when you're anxious or when you're too anxious. It goes way down. This is actually a science. This is not me. And so it goes way down. But what happens is the kid who's on this end, whose performance is way down, gets interpreted as being on the other side, which is that they weren't interested. And the fact is, pressure, okay, do better, you know, stop doing what you're doing, all that is going to make the kid more anxious, and that's what's going to happen to their performance. And that's something that
I just want to say one thing about this. The idea, and this is a word that you mostly heard, I think, the kid is dysregulated. He has to regulate himself. He has to regulate his emotions. That's the ideal for the kid to register. Like, yeah, we're giving these examples of kids that need a little break, and it's red. It's, you know, that kid knows what to do when he's yellow. That's the whole thing. That's why this whole behavioral thing works. Now, the kid has to learn that, regulate himself. If a kid needs to, it feels like there's a meltdown coming, and this girl starts to draw some computer art. If you tell her to stop drawing, we're going to have, you know, but she figured it out. She knows what to, so that's part of this whole dynamic of, if you know what to do if your back hurts, you don't have to worry about your back hurting when going cross country, because you know what to do about it. If you know what to do when you become dysregulated, then that's fine. You're going to be fine.
But often kids don't know what to do. And they, you know, or, and this, we're all getting through slides we have later, so that's okay. But kids, you know, and it's not one size fits all. And OTs can be phenomenal in helping with this kind of thing, because a lot of times they're sensory strategies for helping kids calm down. I had one kid who was, he would go do wall push-ups in the hallway. And that's what calmed him down. I had another kid who would stick his hand in a bucket of sand. You tell me why that works. I don't know, but that worked for him. Or the breathing. So you can't tell every kid breathe, because for some kids that's not going to work. And so it's something working with the kid to figure out not what works. Not just, okay, we're going to teach everyone to meditate and that's it. Because that might not work. Yeah. That's what we're trying. No, and that's why we're writing a book telling children's stories and to bring this to life to people, that this is what it's like, okay? I had one boy in a class who, he really was good at math, and he prided himself on being good at math, but he couldn't do word problems, and that's typical for a lot of these kids. And he'd get so frustrated, he'd start saying, I'm stupid, I'm bad. And then that would get him all upset, and he'd start crying, and he'd start, you know, and he'd end up under the chair, you know, crying. And I said to the teacher, when he starts to get frustrated, can you give him a break, you know, to go to the back of the room and just to, you know, they had a teepee in the back of the room for kind of that. She said, well, I'll give him 2 minutes. And I said, well, do you calm down in 2 minutes? And she said, well, if I give him more than 2 minutes, he'll start taking longer and longer, and then everybody's going to want to do it. And, you know, he's going to use it to manipulate me. Well, this kid didn't like being upset, and he didn't like looking upset in front of his peers. Okay? And so the idea that he was simply going to manipulate with this. So, you know, we had something. This kid was a kid who could use... I'm sorry.
I just...
this kid was a kid who knew a way of calming down by breathing and all that, but he wasn't allowed to do it. And so I think the point that was just made is so important. Where's the space for the input from the kid? And often this input's coming from the parent. And so where's the space to really listen to the parent? Because while in theory the parent is part of the team, a lot of the time the parent feels like they're working against the team.
Right. The parent is part of the team. Right? What you say could be written in the IEP. What I say as an independent person, my name and my thoughts are on these IEPs. So you have that, you know, freedom. But what I wanted to say, something that I learned recently about John Dewey, that you're totally right. The kid should, it's all about the kid, should have the input. But what Dewey says is that the teachers should have total autonomy. The system should be designed, the superintendent, everyone in the system should all be designed to give the teacher what he or she or they need. And that was, oh yeah, that makes sense, because the teachers are tied right by the system as well.
Right, and so a teacher who wants to give him more time is, as you said, trained not to. Or else some teachers do get it and want to, but they don't feel they have the freedom to do it. Right, exactly. We don't have the time.
Right. So we are talking about systemic change, but what I tell all the kids that I see and the parents is, you know, school is the only time in your life when you have to be good at everything, and your job is to come through it with your head screwed on straight. And we'll worry about the rest, but that's what we're trying to do, is have you come through this with your head screwed on straight. The reason for this whole talk is that so many don't, and because there isn't that support for them doing that. Yeah.
They start to bring the children to the IEP starting middle school, so they can participate and they can give feedback. So after middle school, the kids are in the IEPs, but what I found, my son's now a freshman in high school, is he doesn't want to come because it's the teachers all sitting around saying, you have an F in this, you have a D in this, you didn't do these assignments, you were late for class.
Right.
So it's, you know, you, I don't know, almost like the law should be changed so it's separate, so they get the kids' input without all the negativity, because it's just, it's choking them.
Really, I just want to try to, go ahead and then we'll... Yeah, and one thing that happens a lot, which I'm sure, thank you, many you know, of you have experienced, is the kid works so hard to hold it together all day in school and to not get dysregulated and everything. And then the kid is coming home and melts down the moment they hit the door, okay? And the parent's saying to the school, look, there's something going on because the kid's just tearful, he can't do his homework, can't do anything, he's just melting down. They say, well, you know, it's obviously something in the home because it doesn't happen here, right?
His behavior is fine in school.
Right, and so what we're trying to say is, you know, when we talk about the child and the input and the child, we also really are emphasizing that they have to be able to think about the environment, okay? Is this an environment in which this kid can be safe and comfortable to do the kind of advocating we're talking about? Because if the kid is doing advocating and what he's hearing is that we can't, you know, that's the wrong thing to advocate for, you know, you're out of line, all that, he's going to stop doing it, right? So what we need is not just the kid, but the environment. It is that classroom, okay, or the hallway. I mean, if we think about the environment of schools, if we think about the constant social demand, the eye rolls, the, you know, kids kind of, the environment is so stressful for these kids. And we need to think about, if the kid comes home and melts, he spent all day in that environment. And, you know, and if we're in a job where we're in an adverse environment, you know, what do? We come home and we have a martini or something. Well, we don't have a kid martini, maybe a video game. But, you know, they say, well, we're worried that if everybody meditates, they're going to stop complaining about the fact that this job's a horrible place to be. Well, no, we don't. That's not the point of self-regulation, to just tolerate a place that's toxic, right? The idea is that we want to change the place so that it's more, it's not triggering you all the time, as well as giving you tools for dealing with the triggers.
So I want to address your question directly with the kids' participation in the IEP meetings. How many of you have been told, you know your kids your kid best, you're the parent, and then they don't listen to you anyway? Sort of the same thing here. It's really comes to the kind of philosophy that I'm here to tell you what's wrong with your kid when the kid's in the meeting, or I'm here to listen to the parent, but maybe the kid knows himself better than anyone else in the room. I want to listen. What do you have to say? If that's their mindset, is open-minded, and like, help us help you, then it's different. And now we have to change something fundamental.
Yeah, and you know what works best. If you never do a transition with a child without giving them a 15-minute warning or a day warning, right? Then you can tell that, you know, I got to give the kid a warning, because if you just spring something on him, he's gonna, you know, get upset, or I do this, or I handle this way. And it's really important that teachers know that. I often tell teachers, if a kid is really doing well in a particular year and, you know, the teachers have gotten it and they've don't write a, you know, whatever the IEP is, write a bullet point list. This is what works with this kid. You know, give him time, give him warnings, do this. And that lets the next year's teachers get off, you know, hitting the ground running. Because what they need is practical. I'm very pragmatic. What they need is nitty gritty. And if there's some things that work well to help this child, then let's just spit it out and say that, as opposed to have them have to start from scratch and learn it all over again. But we should get to some of our slides. That's not one. So, and we're going to just run through this because obviously most of you know it, that sensory experience is, you know, is something huge. And 80% of kids on the spectrum have some kind of sensory sensitivity. Most of them have more than one. A lot of them have more than one thing going on. So they're ADHD and they're autistic, or they're, you know, they have multiple issues going on. And so we don't think about the sensory environment. Almost never. How many of you have ever been in a school assembly where they don't clap? Okay. Yet if you're in a conference that has autistic people there, they do this.
That's clapping.
All right. If you had a kid who was in a wheelchair, you would expect to see a ramp. But if you have a kid who has sensory sensitivities that are extreme, and there are kids who have sensory integration disorders, all kinds of things like that, there's no accommodations, right? We don't see it, so it doesn't exist. And so we're busy clapping away and making as much noise as we can. And there was a study that if you soundproof the walls, you put that soundproofing stuff, and you put tennis balls on the chairs so that when they go back and forth, they don't make a lot of noise, autistic kids did better. And that's not a huge radical change. But, you know, the idea of making the environment work better is just something that...
And we're not looking for that. The kids be misbehaving. Okay, we know what typically is done, but maybe it's the cleaning fluid that was used in the room, you know, yesterday. You know, we don't think of those things, the lights in the halls or whatever. So that's what part of this talk is, to have an awareness of this.
And, you know, many have sleep disorders, okay? And some huge number of kids on the spectrum or kids with ADHD or others have trouble with sleeping. And so they come in tired. And, you know, they do use sleep deprivation as torture for a reason, okay? So the kid who's coming in tired is already has one thing going on against him. And then if we're starting to get on the kid's case, we're just adding fuel to the fire. And this is an actual quote, so I'm going to play it. This is the one on moving.
Early on, I was told to sit still, stop fidgeting, and be quiet. For me to absorb information, I need to be able to stim. I sway back and forth. I may need to sit on a desk and then be moved to the floor, and then maybe pace in the back of the classroom. It doesn't mean that I was being disrespectful. It meant that I was trying to absorb the information. If I was forced to sit still and be quiet, then I was focused on, am I acting normal? Am I drawing tension to myself? Am I being still enough? I had a choir teacher tell me in middle school to pretend a flagpole is at your spine so you can't move. I would rock side to side. I never forgot that statement and how it made me feel singled out. And also how I was so focused on not moving that I then couldn't focus on the class. There was no way that I could listen to what was being said if I was so focused on how I was presenting myself.
The lyric you saw at the beginning, they would tie her to a chair. Okay, because she's ADHD and autistic. She needed to move. She needed to move to concentrate. So they tied her to the chair.
So again, that's why we had this slide about behaviorism. The behavior is the essence of teaching. So if the kid is sitting still successfully, then okay, that's a good thing. But yet the kid's not listening anyway because the kid's concentrating on not moving. And it's actually doing harm to the child because now good behavior, I'm a good boy. Were you a good boy today? And that means sitting
early
still
on,
all day.
Early on, I was told to sit still, stop fidgeting, and be quiet.
And they lose their authentic self. They get trained to lose who... Marcia sees people who are in their 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, and their sense of self is really damaged. And this is, you could see how this happens.
Right. I mean, I'm trying to get to the next.
For me to absorb information, I need to be able to stim. I sway back and forth. I mean,
there. So, you know, this is something you'll see in just about every kindergarten or just about every, you know, for in the elementary school. And the point is that this doesn't work for a lot of our kids. Kids are taught, make eye contact. You've got to make eye contact. There are so many adults who tell us, and adults, by the way, are grown-up kids, that making eye contact is painful, or they can't think if they're having to make eye contact. But we don't care whether they can think. We want them to make eye contact, right? Or quiet hands, okay? That a kid may need to do some kind of stimming. You know, no, we want you to have quiet hands. We want you to sit. And so this is the model of what listening and learning should look like, but this isn't what it is for a lot of these kids. And that's what you know and what we know. Okay, so this seems to work.
And the self-esteem part of it is what's wrong with me.
Right. Right.
Once a kid says, what's wrong with me, then we have a whole bunch of other problems that come from a low self-esteem.
Right, or a self-image that says I'm not good enough, or I'm a failure. I'm not. There's all kinds of things that come from that. Another point is that a kid who's doing well in school, they'll say he doesn't have a problem, right? He's getting good grades, so what's the problem? The kid maybe this is I have a video an audio of this kid, but basically what he's saying is you can be in school and still struggle even if you're getting good grades. And this guy dropped out in his senior year. Because he was struggling so much, but he got good grades, so nobody really paid any attention to him. So we're showing you this one just because it's very moving and we like it. But this is an interview, and we were asking people to tell us about their school experience.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think that would help a lot.
Steph, when you were saying that your feelings weren't valid, go back to what could or should be done to understand what your feelings were.
Okay, I went to mainstream primary school and in a class full of 30 kids who were all loud and noisy and annoying in a lot of ways, it's very hard to concentrate on what you're supposed to be doing. But the teachers and the TA who was with me, they never seemed to understand that. And there was very much this attitude of, oh, well, everyone else is getting on with it, so why can't you? And it's like, because I struggle with it. I just do. And like I say, I would get overwhelmed. I would melt down. I would say, I cannot do this. I can't do it. They'd put a maths worksheet in front of me and say, here, do this. It's like, I can't do it. I can't do it. And they try and make me do it like, oh, just do it, get it over with. And it's like, it's not that I'm being lazy or objectionable. It's not that I don't want to do it. It's that I just didn't feel able to do it. And them trying to force the issue would then mean that I got more and more upset and annoyed and angry. And at that age, we're talking when I was like 6 or 7, I really didn't express myself well. And I'd just be like, no, piss off. I can't do it. And then I would get violent. I wasn't violent. I just struggled and I didn't know how to express my feelings. And I just didn't feel that they were listening to me. But yeah, I would start, throwing things. I flip tables over and then the teachers would, try and, drag me back to my seat. And it's like, no, I'm not going. and all these things, and then I would lash out at them, and as I say, I'd get violent in inverted commas, and then they'd like physically restrain me, and that was yeah, without question, that was the worst time of my life when I was in primary school.
So this is the kind of thing that I would want to have a discussion, because everyone is looking at this, and I'm picking, every time I see this, I pick something else out, because there's so much there. Everything is there in terms of what we're talking about in our talk today. The one thing that I picked out today was she's 6 or 7. She didn't have the means to express it. All right, so then whose responsibility is, if it's not the 6-year-old's responsibility, whose responsibility is it to listen to this kid and think about what this kid might need? And that's one of the themes of our talk today.
And you can see Steph is in her early 30s, just how meaningful this is to her even now, okay? This isn't something that happened, you know, 25 years ago. And she's over it. This is still something that is so meaningful to her, because her entire education, she was labeled as that violent kid. And nobody thought about, you know, where does that violence come from? She wasn't, as she put it, violent. But if you pushed her hard enough, you know, that's when she lost it.
I asked somebody today, I'm sorry, go ahead. So we're going to go over some of those things of what we can do about it, then ask it again.
But one of the things that I think, luckily we're getting through a lot of our later slides. So, but one of the things that we talk about is that Steph was being seen as being choiceful, right? She was choosing not to do the thing. She's telling them over and over again, it's not a choice. And so a lot of times, it's important to understand that meltdowns are seen as tantrums and they're choiceful and the kid's just trying to get his way, when in fact autistic adults, many neurodivergent adults, will talk about, no, I just got pushed too far. I got pushed to the point where I was overwhelmed by whatever it was that was overwhelming. And then at that point, for one thing, don't ask what's going on, because the part of their brain that has to do with speaking is off board. So trying to get someone who's that upset to explain is just a lost cause. And if at some point they asked Steph to explain, she was telling us it was a noisy classroom and I couldn't think. But sometimes we have to try to figure it out based on what we know. But with Steph's case, if they had just taken her out of the noisy environment, done what she said, and let her, you know, draw for an hour, or do the math some other time, or the TA had stayed out there. I mean, it does depend on the kid. And I realize you can't take 29 kids out of a classroom simultaneously, but you know, in that one case, they had the teepee in the back of the rooms. You know, that one kid could do wall push-ups. That kid, I got into Eagle Hill, and I got into Eagle Hill by begging Dave Silvestro, and who was the school psychologist at the time. And I said to him, "I promise you, if this kid is in the school, he will not be a behavior problem." Okay, I put my reputation on the line. And so he took the kid. And the fact is, an OT figured out that he needed physical stimulation, and that when he started to get frustrated, he went in the hall and he did wall push-ups, and he was never a behavior problem in that school. Okay?
So Marcia said something really important. At the time the kid is screaming, that's not the time to ask the kid what is it? I call it car therapy. When things are calmed down, when you're just hanging out, and that, you know, and then talk about, hey, you know, you had this, you know, behavior, you know, what do you think? Maybe the kid has an idea like, oh, it's like too much noise. Oh, all right, I didn't realize it. So it's okay to talk to the kid, get the kid's opinion, but we don't usually do that, because when things are calm, we don't want to bring up something that maybe that would trigger them. And I'm saying, don't worry about it, talk about it.
Right, or it might be that the kid is bumped a lot in the hallway. You know, as a social sort of social bullying, that they're not actually saying words, but they're bumping him. Or maybe it's that the kid was upset by something that happened 2 periods ago. Or maybe it's because there was a transition. You know, and yeah, we don't want to trigger the kid again. So sometimes the kid will know, sometimes the kid won't be able to say, well, I was triggered because I had to transition. You know, not every kid is going to have that level of awareness, but we have a lot of information. The kind of stuff we're talking about is not secret. It's in a lot of books. If we think about what it looks like, okay, and we might say, did you have a hard time leaving math class? And the kid might say, oh, yeah. You know, like I had one kid, he was a very perfectionist little boy, and he really, 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 really wanted to do well. And so he's slow fine motor skills. And so the teacher had on the board, you know, the math work, and he was copying the math, but it was snack time now. And so she erased the board. And the kid is like, but I don't have it down. I need to have it down. He says, never mind, it's snack time. And she hands him a carton of milk. Guess what happened to the carton of milk? Boom. So we have a behavior problem. Thou shalt not throw cartons of milk. Well, the carton of milk wasn't the behavior problem. And I talked to the teacher and said, is there any way you could just not erase it? You could just leave it up on the board. And she said, well, you know, I teach my classroom my way. I'm like, okay. There's a lot of teachers who will, you know, who will think about something like that. But again, you know, this kid, he probably couldn't explain the whole thing. But we could figure it out if we took the time to reflect, maybe talk to his parents, you know, things like that. So,
oh, yeah.
So what do we know? And I'm going to go through this slowly so many of you are aware. But, you know, we have to understand, how do they learn? What's their cognitive style? A lot of these kids are very detailed thinking. You know, they're very literal. They need it very concrete. And, you know, they always take a deep dive and go into details. For them, multiple choice is great, but give them an essay and they are like, what? Because they've memorized every single detail, but they can't tell you. They don't know what it is you want when you say, tell me the main idea. I had that same kid at Eel Hill. He had no idea what they were talking about when they said, you know, tell me the main idea.
And so the kid may need to be taught the idea of the main idea, getting that. It's a cognitive kind of thing, right?
And unfortunately, he's a senior in high school who has just been accepted at Northeastern. And as of yet, no one still taught him how to get the main idea. He's just kind of, you know, reads Cliff Notes and does stuff and gets through. But, you know, that's something no one takes seriously because he's articulate and he's bright. So I just want to get to the next slide because it's fun.
Go ahead.
Here's your fun break. So here's a very, very detailed thinker being asked a very simple question.
Oh. Per the syllabus.
What is the best sandwich?
Oh, geez. I mean, that's, you know.
We're not playing here, John.
So you can't answer that question in terms of a particular sandwich. It has everything to do with the best sandwich.
You see what's happening here. Why doesn't he just answer the question, right? But he's a detailed thinker, and he's giving all these details that, you know, and you can imagine a teacher saying, look, just answer the question. And this is what John does. He goes into these details that throws Colbert.
Is one that understands the bread to ingredient ratio and does not. So I can't
You're
say
not a
to
hoagie.
You
can't do a hoagie.
Can't do a hoagie. It doesn't matter. What matters is the ratio of ingredient to bread and the addition of your liquidity, whether it be a condiment or a
pickle, let's say.
Well, a pickle is like, you know, too far out there. But I you know, how many of you have ever had your kids psych tested? Yeah, a lot of people. And, you know, for those of you who know psych testing, you know, there's a standard administration of the test. And I had one kid and he was doing vocabulary. I'd ask him what a word meant. And he would go around and around and around and around. And then he'd tell me what the word meant. But that's the way his mind went through every single detail about that word, which were all 1-point answers before he got to the 2-point answer. And I could have cut him off at the beginning and we wouldn't have known that he actually had quite a good vocabulary. And so skip ahead years, I get a call from his tutor at Brown University and says, he takes so long. How do I get him to just get to the point? And I said, you don't. That's how he thinks. Yeah.
Who is supposed to help him at the school? Is it the teacher in that classroom, or is there a way to write things into the IEP that they get extra support during like a study skills class? Or I'm just trying to understand. if we know where our children are struggling outside of getting additional help outside of the school, how do we get them help in school?
Okay, here's 90% of the answer. And that is, we have to know what that is. If our main idea is key for this kid's development, right? And is, you know, I mean, think of what main idea means. That means you're walking down the street by yourself, you know, you're walking home and you can't figure out who's, you know, the safety things, right? That's kind of main idea, who's safe, who you could trust and so forth. So it's a critical concept. If you know that that's it, I'm saying that's 90%. Who does that? Okay, well, ultimately, well, it's an educational system. The school is responsible. But the main thing is to know what the kid needs. That's 90% of it.
Yeah, but to get to the point, you know, that you had made before, there aren't always people who are trained that way. And I'm going to get to a cool slide that will show you, but you know, they're not necessarily trained in how do you help this particular kid with this particular thing. It may be this takes out of the box thinking, and that's not something that we're trained to do. And so, you know, it may be in school there's a gifted speech and language person. It may be in school there's a gifted, you know, special ed teacher who gets it. Hopefully there is somebody. But sometimes there isn't, and that's part of the struggle, is that there isn't.
But is there a way to write the IEP in a way that if you know your child really struggles with inferences, which is really hard in English-type courses because you have to pull on your prior knowledge and then also be able to understand the information you're given and then also respond. So if you know your child struggles in that area, can you write that into the IEP that the teacher needs to work with them?
The short answer is yes. If you look at the law, the IEP doesn't give you any restrictions of how to give an individualized program. That's why it's in some systems it becomes mechanized, becomes automatic, becomes computerized, right? And they just plug in things. The answer is 100% yes. That's what the IEP is supposed to be. So if you get something generated by the teacher, you say, wait a second, this should be on it. You're part of the team. Parents are part of the IEP team, or anyone else the parent chooses could be part of, like me, Marcia, could be part of the team, and that has to go on the IEP.
But for example, one of the many ways that's out there is Linda Mood Bell's visualize and verbalize, or verbalize and visualize, I'm forgetting which it is, but where you read something and then you talk about it, you talk through it, okay, and that helps a kid who's very verbal, or visualize it, you know, but again, that takes time, and you can't necessarily stop everything, but you're going to see this in this next thing. It's the language process.
Per the syllabus, this...
Language processing can be slow for these kids. We talked to someone who is a slow language processor. A kid may not know what's expected. The kid may have trouble, you know, with working memory and being able to hang on to a lot of details. And I want to officially thank the producers of Atypical because they gave me permission to use these clips.
And I'll just say one thing. If you're not doing the
class
right...
will focus on the study of normative ethics, i.e., of course, by being late, somebody missed my announcement that I have a no laptop policy. If the thought of writing with your hand overwhelms you, then go back to first grade. Normative ethics is the study of how one ought to act, morally speaking. Will we touch on meta-ethics? Yes. Applied ethics? Inevitably. Historically, there are multiple... Oh, excellent. I'm just tickled to hear from you again.
Thank you. Can you please slow down, and can you repeat the definition of normative ethics and slow down?
Sure. In fact, you know, why don't we all stop until you're ready?
Great.
Well, he obviously doesn't get social cues. But, you know, again, the kid who has slow motor speed, there are things schools can do. They can assign a note taker, okay? Teachers can give them an outline, so they're just filling things in. And for those who aren't aware of it, there's a thing called a smart pen. It's an echo pen. You take notes in a special notebook, and you just write down a little bit, and then you focus on listening. And if you touch the notebook at that place, it will play back what the teacher was saying, okay? And they have a thing called LiveScribe where it transcribes it onto, you know, into written language on your computer. But so there is artificial technology, you know, assistive technology. There are ways of having help for this. But as you can see, especially as you get into older grades, sometimes that understanding isn't there. And there are teachers like this one who, you know, she's trying to connect to her class with her sarcasm, I hope. But, you know, but for him, that's not working, and it's making people look at him in a negative way.
And if it creates anxiety, now it's like the self-esteem example I've been giving. Now it's an additional problem that may be more...
The rules are simple. If you don't talk...
Insisting on taking notes and so forth and coming in late, whatever it is, if it creates anxiety, then what happens? You have school anxiety. I've had many kids who just don't want to go to school. They just don't want to physically be in that building. And it just doesn't happen by accident. Things like this causes this kind of anxiety.
Yeah, and Rob will sometimes, then you get a kid who's school phobic, right? And then he will do something that's behavioral. We're not saying all behavioral things are bad. So he'll have a thing where we bring the kid to school and sit in the car. And then you bring the school to kids who and you have him, you know, just get at the door, and then you bring him to school and you have him, you know, walk into the building, and then you bring him to school and he maybe sits in one class, and you know, you're gradually working him, and that's behavioral. But it's in the interest of the kid to be able to make the transition back to school. We're not just teaching him rote learning. But, you know, but we're, yeah.
As the mom of a kid who I feel like sometimes misses social cues or behaves in a way that people don't expect him to, I'm always surprised by how emotionally responsive adults permit themselves to be. Like, no, you're the grown-up, like, and he just met you, and if you really think about it, what he did didn't actually hurt anyone, but you just exploded. So that's something that's interesting to me. Like, we're teaching our kids to like manage their emotions all the time, but certain kids, like just the way they move through the world, trigger adults constantly. And so then the kids have to learn to manage adult responses. That's the first thing I wanted to say. And then the other thing I wanted to say, just because we're meeting in Wilton and because certainly I've had many of the negative experiences that you're talking about, like where it got to the point where my kid did not want to go to school and was labeled a major problem child. I also just want to shout out that there's a DBT class at Middlebrook, and the DBT class has a special dean that they meet with who's in there all the time with them, and a special social worker or guidance counselor, I don't remember her exact title, and that my kid's experience of, and they meet with the teachers all the time, and there's just this wraparound. This class is every morning as soon as they get to school. Like, the experience of that for my kid is completely transformative. And he feels like his teachers love him. He feels good at school. So
you hit on something really important. And that is, if a kid's dysregulated, needs to calm down, the most important thing, and I'm not the only one saying, I could give you two books off the top of my head that say the same thing. The most important thing is for you as a parent, a teacher, a person in school, to be calm. And you're saying just the opposite happens. And now the kid is responsible for the adult's action. The adult in the room has to be calm to have a positive effect on the kid.
Yeah, and the other thing is having expectations of the kids. As you said, that a lot of these kids aren't very gratifying. Okay, this is not a kid who's going to say, oh, thank you so much. You know, and I had one school where this kid had dropped out of multiple schools. She was fine, you know, she was in a school where she was working. We got a teacher, you know, one of the teachers to sit down. They had a one-to-one period in this school. It was Winston Prep. And they had a focus class where she's working one-to-one. And the teacher agreed not to jump right into the lesson, but rather to do something that was enjoyable for her to kind of develop a relationship. And then he said, okay, we have a relationship. I want to do the class. No. You have a relationship. Don't just, she's going to be, feel it as a betrayal if all of a sudden you change gears. So they gradually increased the amount of work to the point where she was able to work during her focus period. And I was talking to him and I said, you know, you've just done this amazing job. She's just terrific. And he said, yeah, but I'm still waiting for the day when she walks in and gives me a big smile and says, hi, Mr. So-and-so, it's great to see you. And I thought, oh, shoot, you're going to have a long wait. But teachers are people. And for a kid who doesn't look interested or who isn't giving you that nonverbal feedback or whatever, that can be difficult, you know, especially if you perceive the kid as difficult, disruptive, avoidant, rude, that kind of stuff. But even when you're trying to understand it, you know, it's hard not to for teachers not to get frustrated, too. They're people. And so, it's wonderful that school had that DBT. And maybe part of the answer is every school should have a DBT class, you know, that the kids could be taken out into. And that would be awesome. But we also have to give the teachers a DBT class or give the teachers time to go relax and meditate and build that into their schedules because they've got class after class after class of kids, right? And so when do they have time to self-calm? When do they have time to kind of get it together if they've had a very difficult class? So, we need to think of everybody.
It's classified as ADHD for all these years and executive functioning, but just found out through private neuropsych testing that it's been slow processing. So I've been saying, I think he's not getting it. Been explaining this in PPT meetings and team meetings. Oh, he's getting it. He's capable. He's just so. What's been going on when the work gets really difficult? He is going on his Chromebook and playing video games. And then the teachers are saying, "Well, I'm going to put you facing the class, or I'm going to." They put him up against a wall last year. I'm going to put you on paper. So he's coping in his own way, and because he's not getting, works wonderful with tutors, very motivated, athletic, lots of friends. So again, not a behavioral issue. It really, truly is the difficulty of the academics, and has good grades because of all the remedial support. A kid who's, he's found this coping mechanism, what do you do? Do you let him play video games in class?
All right, I'm a cognitively oriented person as opposed to behaviorally, you'll probably figure that out. And I want to go to the underlying issue, and that is understanding the material. I'll make something up and you could, you know, I don't know your kid, I could be right or wrong, but the idea is understanding something cognitively. And I'm going to use my own story. I'm in organic chemistry. All right, hundreds of little things, right, that you need to know to figure, and you have to write a molecule that's like huge, right? Everyone's writing. And I have my little Tinker Toy set of molecules, right? There's little things, and I created the model. It's on my desk, you could see it. But I need all these little toys for the next problem. I call the teacher over, I say, number 15, that's my answer. In other words, I thought in a different way, and I say, that's my answer. He goes to my book, he puts a big check, number 15. I'll say, go ahead, knock yourself out. My point is that your kid may need to learn something in a cognitive way. They may need to learn the whole picture and then fill in the details. They may need to understand the concept behind algebra. There's an idea behind this stuff.
Yeah, and it is a huge struggle because, as you said, he works well with tutors. He works well, you know, this is a kid who does really well one-on-one, and he's academically, you know, okay. So the school says, well, why should we outplace him? He's obviously learning, and you're saying, yeah, but it's costing me for all these tutors. But the fact is, if what we understand is that the classroom environment is just too overstimulating for this kid, okay? Whether it's social or sensory or whatever, the class environment's too stimulating. Then we sit down and we problem solve. So what do we do? How do we not tell the kid, stop being you in an overstimulating environment? But it's an academic piece in a particular setting. Because he does it, and he does.
Okay, here's a concrete answer. You could have 20 problems for homework, right, math problems, and you could do all of them mechanically. But if you have the idea behind, let's say, algebra, the problem, then you could do anything. You don't have to do the 20 problems because you got the idea. Very often, the idea behind whatever you're learning is not being taught, and the kid's not learning it. So then they have to what? You said the word, cope. I have to get through it. The kid should be engaged and enjoying learning. What happened to that?
Yeah, and you know, and for a lot of these kids, you know, we tend to look at video games as electronics and they're wasting time and, you know, blah, blah, blah. But the fact is, it's a world where they're safe and it's a world where they're in control and a world where they're successful, right? And so he's leaving a world where he's not in control and he's not feeling safe and he's not successful and going to a world where he is. And so the question really is, you know, how do we help this kid learn and how do we make an environment that he can learn in? And as you said back there, nobody's trained in that, right? And we don't necessarily have the resources for that. But again, you know, like that kid that I was telling you about who thinks around and around and around things, you know, he actually got through Brown not going to any of the lectures. He worked from the textbooks because he did much better teaching himself. Right. And so. Right. And so maybe, you know, and as you said about outplacement, maybe this kid would do better in a one-on-one tutoring thing and then going back to school for art. Or for sports, or for things that, you know, that aren't a problem. And so it's that kind of, you know, openness of thinking. You know, maybe you don't have to pay for an entire separate school, but maybe you could have academics taught in a one-on-one where he's learning.
Thank you so much. So I feel like, something that's been touched upon several times are questions about what types of interventions. And my son is now in 11th grade, and so he's been through all the schools in Wilton, and then now he's in a boarding school for kids with ADHD or dyslexia. He's at Foreman. And he's had different interventions at different times over the years, and also not properly diagnosed, by the way, for many, many years. And maybe still not. But he's had aides push in. He's had teachers who also shouts out for some of the interventions have been great, depending on the person. But there was like a first grade teacher who said, I've given him extra help. And she was the one who said he needs an aide coming and helping him with math. So there's always, so he's had gone to a resource room. He's had push in. Then in the later years, academic, there are things called academic lab and flex lab. And so those are also things that can be added to the students. Maybe you guys have more ideas about that, about how those things can be worked within the public school system and, you know, magic words to get those. And I've had he's had mixed experiences with those as well. But reteaching is something that I think can add to. You're talking about this cognitive, like where are they missing that piece and what they need? That's literally something you can ask for, you know, and I've had so much identification with your slide. So I absolutely appreciate that. Like, why does he have to copy out, you know, it should be, and then he's also come up against like teachers are like, no, you know, you have to do that anyway. And then and I'll save another question for later.
I want to give a shout out to SPED NET for this, because on the SPED NET website is a guide for parents to know all of your rights and all of your kids' rights. And because often, you know, it would be great if there was a magic word or, a, you know, bringing in material, bringing in information about your kid, bringing in an expert. You know, there are many, many things to try, but knowing that, you know, you can ask for a meeting, knowing what you can do, knowing what you're, that you can ask for is an important part of it. And of course, as we keep saying, what are the resources in that school? And if the resources aren't there, then are there ways to ask for the resources coming from outside school? So, you know, it's a very complex process. We, you know, we're not pretending that this is easy, but it's, you know, but trying to make sure we're starting out with, well, what's the problem in the first place? And then we can start brainstorming, well, then how are we going to create that with the resources we have where we are? Is that possible? And then go from there.
Amazing teachers, and sometimes there's not so good teachers. But I would say your first line of defense is go to the teacher, and if they can't help you, they can at least say, let me see if I can find somebody who can help you. And that, because if your teacher's spending 6 hours a day with your child, they're gonna have some sort of clue as to what's going on. So maybe they can at least direct you to the right place to go to. That's my suggestion. I'm, again, not trained, so.
I would just take that. A social worker is to partner with a social worker who then you have an advocate. And you talk to them on the
Yeah, and I just want to reinforce the point that you made, which is finding an advocate in the school is so critical. And it might be the social worker, it might be a guidance counselor, it might be a teacher, it might be a special ed teacher, it might be a whole variety of people. But finding, I mean, then we're trying to explain to a parent, you know, a father, why we needed this. And he's like, I don't understand, why can't he just do it? And I said, you know basketball? And I don't know if any of you know basketball, but there's a guy on the court who passes the ball to different people, and he's the point guard. And I said, you need a point guard. And he goes, oh, I understand. Okay. So, you know, you need somebody who's going to, but again, you need somebody who has the time. You need somebody who's,
getting these teachers who can be not very nice. And the elementary school did a really wonderful job with teacher placement, and he thrived. And now he's in middle school, and he's going on video games because they're just like, focus, focus, focus. And it's really frustrating. And then he has like an LA teacher who's wonderful, who he completely relates to and gets. So it's
before we get to the person in the back, I just want to say, with a lot of these kids, they're not connected to anybody in the school. And I'm saying all these kid needs is one person who could get them. You know, it could be an aide, it could be the person serving the food in the kitchen. If there's one person who could really get and understand this kid, that's gonna have the kid calm down a little. But the question is a question in the back.
Well, I just wanna piggyback on what he said though, and to your point, which is, the kid needs a safe person in school. The kid needs somebody who feels accepted, who's not judging him, who actually likes him. But the team also has to be willing to listen to that person. Because if what we're saying is that boy who was going into math class late, he came home and he said, my math teacher hates me because she felt disrespected, right? And so we have to have somebody who the team will listen to. I've gone into a lot of schools. You know, the advantage of having us go into schools is sometimes they listen to us in ways they don't listen to teachers and parents, and I'm sorry about that. But, you know, and not everybody can afford to have somebody from the outside go into school. But really having somebody who's going to be heard is so important to tell. You know, I remember I went into school about one boy, and I said, basically, he thinks all of you hate him. And they were shocked because they had no idea that the way they were behaving was making this kid feel that everybody hated him. And so that was the beginning of a very productive dialogue in terms of how they were relating to this kid.
She is on the spectrum, but has a variety of other disabilities. So it's been kind of a rough time for her lately, and we've gotten to the point where I just got a new behavior plan. So as a parent, and I think we have one particular teacher that doesn't get her, but as a parent, what are the things I should look for? How should I evaluate the plan to say, yes, this is meeting my child's needs or it's not, as we go forward? Because I want to make sure, you know, she's a kid that shows, you know, glimmers of her intelligence, but is impossible to sort of test. And it's hard to get her to actually do, you know, what she is capable of and to motivate her to do that. So I think high school's kind of been fumbling their way along. And we've finally gotten to the point where we want to put a plan in place to make sure everybody's on the same page with her. And, you know, using the same language, et cetera. But how do I, as a parent, figure out whether this is right for my kid and, you know, what should I be looking for?
Well, one of the things that I think is important is that you're creating a plan, right? You're in a meeting, they come up with a plan, you say you're going to think about it, you get back, everybody agrees on a plan. One of the things that I would do, and Eve back there can tell me whether or not this is something that you can do, but I would say, let's try this out for 4 weeks. Let's give this a month. Let's give this a period of time that seems short enough to not traumatize your kid, but reasonable, and say, let's put it on the calendar that we are reconvening in 4 weeks, and what are we going to look for to decide whether or not this is working, okay? So that you have built in to the whole thing something that's going to look at this and is it working, okay? And how do we know if it is or it isn't? Because that's a critical thing. You can put something in motion and at the end of the semester you find out that that nothing's happening. So you want to build it in. Eve, would you agree?
I love what you just said. I just want to add one more thing that people don't think of when they look at a behavioral plan. Is the kid happy? Happy? What is that? Why not? Why can't a kid be happy and not anxious all day?
Or at least okay.
Should we go on with the next one?
I think all kids, I mean, the guy who's the head of the Center for Emotional Intelligence at Yale, Mark Brackett, did a study of kids in high school, and they asked him to come up with adjectives that describe their experience in high school. The number one was bored, and number two was stressed, and number three was tired, okay? If you ran a business and you found out that most of your employees described it as bored, stressed, and tired, would you feel like you were running it successfully? So let's not, you know, our kids aren't the only ones in that school who aren't happy. We're going for at least not unhappy, right? And, and content to be there. And maybe actually having a really positive experience sometime of someone who's interested in them. And I do want to try to get on with some of these slides.
The only thing I want to say about this slide with participation that could cause a lot of anxiety for a lot of these kids is that I had one kid who, when he wanted to say something, we'd have to whisper the answer to the teacher because he didn't want to be embarrassed and all of that. And very high. And then teacher would either say the answer and repeat the answer. But it's this kind of thing of participation. That's a loaded issue for that as a requirement for kids to do.
Yeah, if there was one thing that I would say we hear most from the adults who come back to us about their experience or talking about their kids is that the participation grade is what kills them. Because, you know, I put on here, you know, some of the things that get in the way, but, you know, and
Should we start?
The rules are simple. If you don't talk by the time that clock says 10:25, you fail. Your topic is artificial intelligence. You should be talking by now.
Well, I think to know what the impact of artificial intelligence is in our society, we need to define what society means.
AI won't kill us before climate change.
I heard surgeons can implant screens in people's bodies
now. I talk to Siri more than
screens.
I talk to my mom.
Nobody's going to be able to live if there's no planet to live on.
You don't, for all you know, I'm a robot.
10:25.
Excuse me. I think I'm in the wrong class. Is this intro German?
There's you no should be talking about society about an AI robot. The world is so genius.
Time.
And that's how a lot of our kids do experience this participation grade. You know, what are you going to say? When are you going to say it? How do you break in? You know, how long you can go on? Maybe because you're so detail-oriented, you're perceived as off topic. And how does the teacher handle that? I was at New York Hospital, and there was this guy who was like, you know, God, as far as, you know, where he was as an author and everything. And he was doing for all the residents and psychology trainees a, you know, ongoing case conference. And guess who got to present the therapy I was doing every week? Me. And I'm like, oh, but I did it. And this man was a genius at taking whatever I did and making it into a learning experience. And I can't say as a, you know, first year trainee, I was perfect, but he made everything work, you know, and a teacher in participation can do that, but many don't. Many just say, well, that's off topic, you know, as opposed to, you know, that's really interesting. You're making a good point, and then going on to the next kid so the kid feels validated. So this participation thing is huge, and trying to, you know, let people know when that is a problem, and, you know, and not just have the kid get a zero because he's not saying anything. Sorry?
That the kid talks too much. Yeah.
I have a great story about that I had a kid, and he was a young kid, and he'd been in a school where the teacher had a very verbal way of you know, teaching. And this kid was very verbal. It really worked. Then he went to a new school, and the teacher had a very visual way of teaching. Very, you know, everything was through visuals. And this kid suddenly went from being a superstar to not that good. And he didn't like that. So what he did is he used his abilities. He corrected the teacher's grammar every time she said something wrong. That wasn't appreciated. But also, again, remember that slide about detail thinking. For a kid who thinks in details, they've got all these details, but they may not know which ones you're looking for at that moment. So the kid may try to tell you everything he knows, or feel that the only way to explain something is to going into every detail. And sometimes it takes working with the kid. Like, I'll tell a neurodivergent kid, look, you know, you are great. You know so much, because it's so important to validate the kid. But you have to understand neurotypicals have very limited minds. There's only so much they can take in at a time. So the idea is it's like a tennis game. You're hitting the ball across the net. You give them one idea, okay? And give them a chance and see if they can hit it back. And if they can't hit it back, it's over. But if they can hit that back and they ask you a question, then you hit them another idea, because they're really only capable of taking in one idea at a time. That was a very nice way of telling this kid to talk less, right? But he got it, you know, that made sense to him. So again, that idea of kindness, the idea of not telling the kid, well, you're doing a bad thing, you talk too much, but rather, you are so full of information. It's amazing, but how can people hear you, you know?
So if we get to the slide, we're going to have a slide of a kid that asks. So you're going to actually see that. So I'll talk about that.
We're going to try to get more of these. So, you know, this is the thing you're going to hear a lot about, and I'm going to race through some of this. But, you know, executive functions. And executive functions are certainly there for ADHD, autistic, NLD, but a lot of other kids have executive function issues. And executive functions, you'll get a coach for the kid and they'll say, okay, make sure all of their homework is written down on a planner, you know, make things like that. That's not all there is to executive functions. It's being able to be started. It's being able to maintain your effort. It's having working memory. It's being able to shift. We've talked a lot about shifting. You know, if you're writing, you have to shift from thinking of what you're going to say to how do you form that in words, to how do you write a grammatic sentence, to how do you actually do the motor act of writing, to how do you go back to, is this on the idea that I was doing? It's a huge amount of shifting. It's a perfect storm if you've got executive functions problems. So, you know, and being able to self-regulate, all of these are executive functions. And so when you have a kid who has executive function problems, their verbal IQ may be way up there. Their nonverbal IQs and problems may be up there. Why? Because they're in a one-to-one setting with a psychologist who's keeping them focused, right? But when they've got to do all this their own and they do executive functions on their own, it doesn't work out. There's something called the BRIEF, the Behavior Rating Inventory of Executive Function, which is a great measure because it's about what they really do and not about how they perform one-on-one with somebody in a quiet room. But so, I want to just show this because it's, I'm very bad at moving these things. Let me just show this. Okay. Oh, you want to tell the birthday party?
Yeah. So my test for executive function is what happens you want to throw a birthday party. How do you do that? All of those things, that whole list, you know, shifting. What happens if someone doesn't come? The kid says, I'm going to invite my friends. All right, well, then you have to organize. You have to get things ready. And what kind of food, how much food, all of this, how are you going to get the food? And if we look at this list again, you have working memory. They have to be organized. They have to be a continuous thought process. That's one of my favorite things that I'm sharing with you. The idea of throwing a party, what do you do? How do you do it?
Yeah, or a very simple one that's in the psych testing in neuropsych is you ask a teacher kid, I think it's in the NEPSI, is how do you make a peanut butter sandwich? And you have to go, you have to get out the bread, you have to get out the peanut butter, you have to get out the jelly, open it all up. It's where I found out that most people put the jelly on one side and peanut butter on the other, because I always put the peanut butter and then put the jelly on top of it. But anyway, you know, so they have to be able to organize, get the big picture, go step by step. But being able to, being able to think that through is so critical. And sometimes, for example, a kid will have a lot of ideas, but they may need the teacher to write the first sentence to help them get started. You know what I mean? The teacher talks, what do you want to write? Well, let's get you started, okay? Or maybe they need some way to have a way of handling working memory, okay? So maybe they take notes on the side about points they want to make. Maybe ideas come to them as they're writing. They don't want to lose the idea, but they can't. They don't want to miss the flow of the writing. So working with the kid, understanding what's going wrong. And I just want to get to this.
Because we have some parents of older kids, what's the hardest job question for a job interview? Tell me about yourself. Where do you start? When you're born? I mean, that's like an executive functioning thing. How do I get started? They need to learn these kinds of things. And I do some job training. What to do at a job interview so you're not totally thrown.
Yeah, I want to show you this. This is on many neuropsych batteries. It's called the Ray Osterick. And the thing on that side is a complex figure, right? And the thing on what you tell the kid to do is to draw it. So this girl did a pretty good job of drawing it, right? And if I'm going to throw this out to you, if you were going to have to draw this and you knew you're going to have to draw it again when I take it away, how would you draw this thing? Okay, louder. Big swear. Say what? Right, bigger structures. So if you look at it, there's a square, right, or there's a rectangle, right? And it has diagonals, and it has a vertical, and has a horizontal, okay? And then there's there's a triangle on top, and there's a triangle on the side, right? And then there's all these little things in it. So this girl was brought to me after she dropped out of her fourth college. She had a verbal IQ of 140, all right? Smart kid. Verbally, this is what her Ray Osterick looked like. The deal is 20 minutes later, I say, remember that really weird thing I had you draw? Draw it again. And this is what she drew. She had absolutely no idea that there were organizing shapes. She had absolutely no idea of the big picture. All she was remembering was the details she could remember, okay? If this is how she thinks, then what's going to happen on so many school tasks? So what happened is when she had to write a paper, in high school, she had always talked them out of having her write papers by doing these magnificent multimedia things that, you know, were so creative. But in college, they made her write a paper. And the first time they assigned a paper, she dropped out. So she was on her fourth college, and the tutor said, make an outline. Well, if this kid knew how to make an outline, she could write a silly paper, right? She had, you had to come up with some creative way of having her get all her ideas down there, and then, you know, the details, and then checking back to see, are there other things? And then maybe making a map where you circle things that go together. And, you know, there, again, out-of-the-box creative ways of helping her learn how to bring things together. But on her own, this is the way her mind worked.
I think we should just move on to the next slide here.
Okay. I mean, the idea of social skills that, you know, that we want to just address is that so often social skills are taught in terms of expected behavior and by rote, okay? You will ask three questions. You will introduce yourself. You will ask three questions on topic. If you're in a restaurant, this is how you order. You know, very, you know, this is the expected rote behavior. And it, number one, it may have nothing to do with what the kid wants, all right? So it's not coming from the kid. It's learned behavior, and you do the right things. So I said before, if the right thing is always to say yes, you could get in trouble. But, you know, if you start with the kid and what do you want, then the kid, you then in that context, a school that you and I know about, they had this kid, and he was not willing to go to a social skills group. He was given no social skills, you know, help, and he, and all kinds of terrible things were happening. But the kid was very, they gave him an outplacement job bagging groceries. Well, he scared the people half to death because he didn't have facial expression, didn't smile, so the customers didn't like him. They fired him, okay? But this kid was really, really, really smart in biochemistry. And so I finally got the school to put him in a biochem lab with a professor at UConn. And then he came back to do social skills around, how do I work in this lab team? That he would engage in. All right. So being able to sort of do something that's meaningful to the child and have the skills needed emerge, you know, in an organic way from the child's needs, that made a lot of sense. And the other point we wanted to make is that so much of it depends on context. So, you know, not every context works. If you were an American psychiatrist and you went to Japan where people bow, and even adults sometimes bow to kids if they're like in a service capacity and they're waiting on the kid, well, that's a lot of non-functional head bobbing, right? Stimming. No, it's very functional. It's a way of communicating respect. If you're in Japan, you might bow, you might not bow. Bowing is not bad, not bowing is not bad. It has a meaning. Okay, and you can choose to do it or choose not to do it. So I tell kids, you've got to be an anthropologist. You've got to look. So I had a little boy who was 11. He was a hugger. No, you don't hug people when you're an 11-year-old boy. But he was going on a basketball team. So the question was, how do you greet people if you're on a basketball team? And no, it's not what you were taught in your social skills group. You go in and what do? You go,
oh, yeah.
All right. That's how we do it. Or you do this here.
I'm still learning.
I'm still teaching. But anyway, you do the handshake, you do the fist bump, you do something like that. That's how you greet somebody. And so you have to look at the context and say, where, you know, introducing yourself and asking three questions works if you're at a church social, but it might not work in the basketball team. It might not work if you're in a different kind of context. Yeah.
And the focus on teaching to the test. I found in my last years, there was very little time to do what we as teachers, what I as a teacher wanted to do. And it pushed me out.
Yeah, and that's what we're talking about how many good teachers' hands are tied. And again, that's why we're talking about systemic change. We're not just talking about blaming a teacher or, you know, we're talking not only about the resources the school has, but and maybe having a DBT program in the school, but also untying a teacher's hands so you can respond to the kids that you have. And if there's some kid that you could connect to, letting you connect to that kid.
So we can go on to the next thing. So with these social skills, every social group, it's sort of its own context, own community. You don't have to go to Japan, right? The idea of different culture, there's going to be a different culture with a group of friends, right? They have their own language or whatever, and the kid doesn't fit in. He may have to learn that. So here's a slide. I'm bringing this kid to the sandbox, and like, all right, I'm kind of trying to figure out what is the context here. And my kid goes over there and just steps on one of these piles, one of these, what do you call it?
The sandcastles.
Thanks, sandcastles, right? He steps on it, he walks away, and the other kids are kind of upset, but not too upset. And it's like, now, you know, hey, you know, look, at it didn't, that didn't work, that didn't fit in. It might have fit in if they were all doing that, but that didn't fit in. So then he went to a different group, and he saw a kid like pouring sand into a toy that made a wheel turn. And then he realized he could be part of that by giving this kid sand, like a bucket of sand, to get the sand to put in to the toy that made it turn. And okay, now he assessed the situation, he got it, and now he's part of it. And that's not easy for our kids.
And I think that, you know, I don't know if we have time for the story for the next slide. Is that okay?
Well, the next slide is my favorite slide.
I know. But the idea is that if the kid wants to make a friend, then, you know, we talk about perspective taking. We talk about that kind of thing. Sometimes drama is a really good way of doing it. Sometimes watching videos, that's one thing I did with kids a lot. I mean, even a kid who's on the spectrum and doesn't get anything can tell you the Squidward does not like SpongeBob. Okay, well, how do you know? Okay, or we used to watch Harry Potter because Hermione was really terrible at social skills at the beginning, right? And so sometimes we watch things to help the kid understand something like that. Oh, what's working is that he is, you know, giving him something that helps him do what he wants to do. Ah, I get it. And it's not threatening because you're watching it there. And, you know, so there's all kinds of tools we have. You know, we can be standing in line in a supermarket. And, you know, how can you tell that that person at the front is the check cashier is tired, okay? And then somebody starts, you know, badgering her about something. Well, how's she going to react? So we have all kinds of ways of teaching skills that are, you know, organic in the setting, that are part of there and not some theory that we're learning by rote. So,
you know. So I love what you're saying. And so here we have two kids. Number one, if you listen to what Marcia said a couple of slides ago, number one, these are two kids who wanted to have a friend. It's coming from them. That's number one, what the kid wants. Neither one of these kids had a friend. Think about it. Kids don't have friends, and they go into
he did.
What he did to you?
They go into a recreational program where they're supposed to, on the mission statement is to establish friends, and they go bowling. Well, it doesn't work. At the end of the bowling for whatever, 3 months, they're not establishing friends. I think there has to be some intervention. We have to do something. They have to be taught to learn how to establish a friendship relationship. Now, I like this slide because you have one kid that continually asks questions. He didn't care what the answer was. His issue, his wiring, right? That's the title of this talk. He just ask. We have another kid who's the first one there, and he was a loner. He wouldn't listen. He was a perfectionist. He was in his own world. He would get a 98 on a test, be so upset, ripped up the test, and didn't go to school for 2 days. So he was just in his own world, right? So they had to learn to be friends. So you'll see my intervention and what I did in order for them to be connected.
Yeah. I mean, we're going to have to get through.
Oh, wait, let me just see if I can get it.
Yeah, he did.
What he did to you with that tool?
He attached an explosive barrel to me.
How you managed to attach it?
With a remote claw.
Wait, I don't know why it's...
No, I mean how you managed to dodge it, the explosive barrel.
I countered it.
What that means?
You'll see in a fight.
What is count?
See what happened? He didn't answer. I've seen this, you know, dozens of times. What does counter mean? He didn't answer. And I was there to say, hey, wait a second, you missed it. This is how they were six sessions ago. They just talked through each other, right? This kind of intervention was needed for them to be connected. So I only had to do it once during this little interaction.
Yeah, unfortunately, the idea of inclusion is often that you drop kids into a mainstream place and magically something's going to happen. You know, it's going to rub off or something like that. You can even put a kid into a club where they're interested in, but they'll be in the club and then everybody else will walk away. The kid doesn't have a friend. And so what Rob did is he found two kids who were pretty well matched. And that's something that doesn't happen very often. You know, using what we know of the kids, matching the kids, and then kind of helping them learn how to listen to each other, helping them, you know, interact with each other. They then pick it up on their own. But this sort of idea that all you have to do is throw a kid into an environment and magically the other kids are accepting and they are picking things up, it just doesn't work that way, which I think all of us know.
And by the way, we're looking for a genuine friendship. They saw each other every week, because they really insisted, every week for 2 years. They went out, movies, whatever. For 2 years, they were, until the older one went to college. Every week for 2 years, they were genuine. That's what we're looking for, right? Genuine friendships.
Now, we're going to kind of go through some of this quickly because we spent a lot of time talking about it already. But basically, you know, again, with the meltdowns we talked about, what is the kid experiencing? What's actually going on? Why is it going on? And then how can we help the child? And obviously, we talked about staying calm, but we also talked about, you know, different strategies. And there are, you have this in your handout, you know, there are a lot of different strategies. One doesn't work for everyone. Maybe a kid needs sensory strategies. Maybe a kid needs space. Maybe a kid needs to listen to certain music or have a break to do something that, you know, something else. But telling them to stop is sort of like saying, well, don't be you. Okay, don't be overwhelmed right now. If you were overwhelmed and you had like six kids and one was running around and one was running that way and you were supposed to be cooking dinner and somebody was asking you questions and you're overwhelmed, and I just say, so don't be overwhelmed. Would that really help? No. So, you know, let's not blame the kid. And so, you know, but this is how it's often done, right? If you can read the slide, there's going to be one test. Everybody has to climb the tree. Well, you've got a very happy monkey and everybody else is not happy in the slightest because that's not going to work for them. What we need is a place that's able to do all the things we spent this whole time talking about, which is to individually problem solve, to try to find the resources, to try to find the space for the resources, and trying to, you know, find a way that is based, that's organic to that kid.
You know, people are asking, What do we do about it? What do we do? How do we get the school to, right? Wait, these questions kick. Here, this is a concrete example. My client is outside the circle, sitting outside the circle. Afterwards, I went to the teacher. I said, you know, the two kids are sitting in front of them. All they have to do is put their arm, one hand out, take this kid's hand, and the other kid take the other hand, and now the kid's in part of the circle.
Yeah.
And the kid was all right with that. I know the kid would. So it's like, it could be something really simple.
Yeah, or there was a girl who's actually, you know, probably a genius, but she was apraxic and nonverbal, and they all assumed she was intellectually deficient until she actually learned to type, and then it turned out that she was more articulate than graduate students. But because she's apraxic and doesn't have good control of her body, it's very hard for her other kids to relate to her. But what happened one time was the teacher put on music and the kids started just dancing and swaying, and she was dancing and swaying, and she felt part of it. And for her, this was just an experience that was worth the entire year. And so sometimes the solutions are just out of the box, but not that difficult. You know, finding something they could all do. Yeah. And so our bottom line is build on their strengths, validate them, understand their experience, use their strengths, and then let them have a positive experience, because kids learn better in strength-based learning, and what we tend to have is deficit-based learning. And so trying to bring in what the strengths are, because there's nothing more frustrating than really, really trying and having nobody understand it. So the bottom line, the takeaway of all of this is understanding experience, working from experience, using the tools available to you to communicate that, to be part of the team, to bring for schools ideally to have the resources to be able to respond to the individual, because that's the level that it works on. And yeah.
I think we should kind of officially end it, and then we could stay for some
questions. Let her just make her point. Well, that's why we're writing a book on this. Yeah, they're not getting the training, and you're welcome to share this with them. And we're also writing a book on this, and you can bring people into schools, because it's so critical that they get this training. Well,
thankfully, a number of people have asked. They wrote me before, and they say this should really be a teacher training. I didn't tell that to you before, but I'm just saying that is something that parents are asking for.
Yeah, no, when we're invited to do this with schools, we always do it. We're both lousy entrepreneurs, but we really care, and we really want people to have this kind of training. And so, and the nice thing is this video will be on the SPED NET website.
So right. And it will be sent to everyone, including all the teachers who wrote me this morning that they couldn't come,
But I'll say this, the video is not going to change the mindsets of the teachers. I went to India to a school that was behavioral. It was a big deal. It was a very big deal. And I was going to give this input. I talked for 3 hours. I showed them what to do. And they couldn't change what they've been learning for years and years and years. And you need time. You need an interaction. You need to get questions. You need to... So it's more than just, they should show this. Yeah. It's more than that. You need to train people.
Ideally, it's more than a one-shot deal. Ideally what we would do is we would have, some kind of lecture or something like this, or a workshop or whatever, but then kind of be available to come back in and problem solve and talk about things that come up and ways of thinking about them and thinking together. As you see, our thing is thinking together, not just giving people prescriptive responses. And as you said, a lot of it is parents coming together. SPEDNET is trying to facilitate that. And because every parent is in there on their own. And what we need to do is to give them resources to bring in and knowledge that I'm not by myself, and this is what's worked for other people. So thank you guys so much. Anyone who wants to stay for a few minutes, I think maybe
we can. If you want, you can keep the video running.
And by the way, parents are the ones that have the power. Thank you. Parents are the ones that have the power. Special ed, as we know it, was started by parents in the 50s. I think that's where the grassroots come in.
Thank you. I sat on the special ed board in Westport for 6 years, and just for the parents that are here with the younger children, not only do you have your annual IEP, you have your triannual. You can also request mapping, which when I sat on the board, I called it the secret sauce, all these things that we as board members learned we could ask for our individual kids, but unless the parents came to our meetings, they didn't learn about them, but mapping would map out where you would like to see your child, or you feel your child might be coming out of high school. So instead of not thinking about it until eighth grade, they start you on this, which is fantastic. I didn't know about it. And then you can also call an emergency IEP at any point. So if you have something that's not working, I called the Friday before school vacation, and I have an IEP on Wednesday next week.
Yeah.
So that's just how it's the secret sauce, and it's good to know.
But what would be really great, since you're in one school district on a committee that's doing this, if there was a connection between the parents in one school district and the parents in another school district, and there was a way for people to kind of form some kind of forum where people could bring in problems and know what worked in other school districts. Part of the problem is everybody is in their own school district. Everyone is with their own child. You don't even know what's going on with other children. So this communication, this is what worked here. This is what was really successful here, but you're struggling with something similar where you are, and you are, you know, where you are. If there was some way that, you know, either if there's, you know, special ed parent, you know, PTAs or whatever, for people to kind of be in contact and get people from different districts together so that there could be a sharing of what works. There could be a sharing of how do you get your voices heard, which is what you asked back there.
So I just want to share that for my son's IEP, there was an outside FBA done. And one of the recommendations by the outside FBA was training for the teachers. And so I encourage everybody to ask, because
it's part of kids, some of the kids that I've worked with have part of their plan that there be outside training. So, Eve, thank you so much for inviting us.
Thank you so much for coming. It's been awesome.
And write to us. We're here for any questions. You can still write. And we have our contact is up there. Well, it was up there.
Oh, no.
I had a quick question. I have a 12-and-a-half-year-old who was diagnosed as autistic at 11-and-a-half. And she was diagnosed because the social world became so complex. Her anxiety level reached such a state that she was vomiting, self-harming. So she was put last April at the Pinnacle School. So she's been there not quite a year. And she's been struggling with anxiety again in that environment. I think it's the sensory stuff. So she's not the typical kid that they get. Like, they get a lot of kids who have major behavioral issues where they'll scream for 40 minutes. And I think with her sensory issues, the environment is too much and she's starting to vomit again. And I have a PPT, our annual PPT, next week. And we have had a couple meetings with the principal in the last like 6-8 weeks talking about this. And he said to me recently, well, you know, she's got to learn to cope, you know, in different environments. And I was thinking about what you said. You know, when I got out of graduate school, I had a horrible job that was toxic. And my mentor said to me, get another job. Don't try and make it work. So part of me is like, yeah, I understand she's got to learn to cope in some ways to be in the world, but clearly this environment isn't good for her and it's triggering her anxiety. So what do I say to that principal at a therapeutic day school who's telling me my kid has to learn to cope in an environment that she can't cope in?
And, you know, and she's how old?
She's 12 now.
Okay, so one of the things I would say to him, if he wears glasses, tell him to take his glasses off and cope. Okay?
Yeah.
Tell him, because the fundamental thing that we keep getting, we're trying to get over and over again, is being able to understand the neurodivergent experience. You know, take him into a small closet and clap cymbals together as loud as you can. In other words, there's actually, if you Google it on YouTube, there's a, or you look on YouTube, I think Autism Society, someone has autistic experience of sensory environment, and it shows what it's like to be in a sensory environment. I think it's a kid walking through a shopping mall. But what we need to do is bring to life to this guy that's saying just cope doesn't work. Because when she gets out of school, when she's in college, she can ask for a single. She can wear noise-canceling headphones. You know, she can do all kinds of accommodations. And it's in the, and you can tell him this, it's in the Americans for Disabilities Act, that I better put my glasses on. It's in the Americans for Disabilities Act that autism is considered a disability. And one of the accommodations for autism is sensory accommodations. It's the federal law. Okay, so that an employer has to make sensory accommodations, and a school should be making sensory accommodations. And if the school can't make sensory accommodations, then she needs to be somewhere where they can, where wearing headphones, where doing other things, you know, makes the environment work, but they're also understanding and not saying, well, basically what he's saying is, don't be autistic, okay? Don't be you. Don't process the way you do. And, you know, and so you've got to bring that home to him. Look for that YouTube video. Okay, and you've got to find some way of saying you don't understand. And according to the ADA, my kid is going to be able to get accommodations when she's an employee, and she should be getting these accommodations now. And telling and strategies for coping are one thing, but when she's working, she's going to be able to. I had one woman who was an MD. Okay, and she realized she couldn't be in a hospital. Lots of noise, lots of lights, lots of all that, and she ended up in a small private practice with just a few people and a quiet environment. Okay, so our kids can pick environments when they're not in school.
Right.
Right.
Yes.
So so we've got to get that message to him. And like I said, use the video.
Yeah. I think I was so shocked because this is a therapeutic day school, and if anybody would get it, you'd think they would. So I was really shocked by that.
Well, I was in a therapeutic day school that was not very dissimilar. I'm not trying to say anything, but you get what I mean. And this kid was really struggling. And I said, look, let's have a plan where there's three goals for this kid. Okay, just three. And they had one goal was that he was going to be a class on time. One goal is he wasn't going to sit in the piano bench that was in the lobby. And the third goal was he was going to abide by all the rest of the rules in the school handbook. And I said, that is not what I mean. Okay? So they got it down to three rules. Okay? And he was doing all of these rules. And he said to me, you know, kids get commendations, you know, when they're doing good. I've never gotten a commendation. So I talked to the head of school. I said, he says he's doing it. And she said, he is. I said, but he never gets an accommodation. He said, well, the teachers are still mad at him. And this was a therapeutic school. All right. So, you know, that's what we're up against. You know, they were not trained.
And by the way, you can take a picture of this if you want. I saw somebody do that. Go ahead.
All these years up until high school. She's been doing well up until high school, and then she breaks down, getting into high school. The issue that she has is, like, when she encounters testing at school, because of the high level anxiety, she knows the stuff, but that she breaks down and cannot answer or do anything in class. How do I, how do we address that through school?
So is she in special ed or
she's on a 504 now, but not in an IEP.
Okay. Yeah.
Yesterday, I was with a psychologist, and she said she had ADHD. So we were doing some testing. And, I'm just trying to figure out what the best way to address it.
Yeah, the simple answer, and we've talked about this, she has rights, and you have rights as a parent. The 504, she has rights to be accommodated. So if she needs all those questions asked, right, or she needs a separate location, she's entitled to that.
Yeah, and the question about assessment is, you know, if you feel the school is not, you know, you can ask for an assessment. Isn't that right, E?
Sorry?
No, no. I mean, he can ask the school to evaluate the kid.
But she might want to discuss having an IEP as opposed to a 504 plan, which would give her a much more individual life.
So this is what we did. When we asked the school, and the school was going to take like 5-6 months before we can get an evaluation done, we did a neuropsych evaluation outside of school. But, you know, the evaluation that was done, I don't think caught the ADHD that she was diagnosed yesterday. No, neuropsych did not.
Well, you know, one thing is if the neuropsych doesn't, and the school, or what's been done, is this outside the school or inside?
Outside of school.
Okay. I can tell you, as someone who did neuropsych testing for 25 years, Eve can attest. As someone who did neuropsych testing for 25 years, which is something that you lived through, I can tell you that my way of doing it was that I saw what was the issue with the kid, and I had to do everything I could until I figured out why. But a lot of people do a battery of tests, and they say, okay, this is how the kid did on the battery of tests, and, you know, nothing's, there's no problem here. And so it may be a clinical issue. You may have to say, we need somebody else to interview this kid and to try to understand what's going on. You know, sometimes these, you know, someone who just does a battery doesn't pick up on what it is that we need to know. And so, you know, Eve, what can they legally do if they need something outside an IEE?
Give her the mic.
Maybe they should go in and view her in the classroom or view her where she really manifests the disability.
Not being able to test.
That go along with her ADHD.
Yeah, and, you know, and to say what Eve was saying, that you can request that somebody come into the classroom and actually, because so many times a kid can do on tests something they can't do in school, because tests, you're sitting one-on-one with someone who's prompting you in a quiet space, okay?
And it actually doesn't matter. I mean, I understand that
Eve, take the mic.
I understand that she's in high school, but when my son was in high school, somebody came in and followed him around the whole day and saw what he was doing and how the AD impacted him in every single class. You know, a lot of it has to do with a language-based class next to another language-based class, and it's too much, or a stimulating class next to another highly stimulating class. So that is something that is absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, SPED NET is a great resource because not only is there so much on the website, but they, you know, you can learn what there is that you can ask for, okay? Well, you know, ideally a neuropsych or an IEE, an outside neuropsych, would pick up on learning issues. Right. But again, sometimes FBAs are by people who are clinically savvy, and sometimes they're not. It's by someone who's counting behavior. So you may have to ask for somebody outside to come in. And somebody outside to come in. I was called to a school once where they had a girl and they said she was a behavior problem, okay? And everybody talked about, you know, that this kid was just, you know, how horrible this kid was. And I followed the kid around and then I went to a meeting and it turned out the only time this kid was horrible was in English class, right? It was the most language heavy class, and she, you know, and they asked her to write and she couldn't write. And so they're generalizing this kid's behavior. So having somebody who is, you know, sensitive and clinically trained and thinking outside the box, not just counting how many behaviors does she have in the day. She had a lot of them if you took all from that one class, but rather what's going on? What are they doing here that's different than somewhere else to understand what's going on? That's understanding is what we're all about here. Understanding what is it that the kid is experiencing that's giving rise to the problem.
Yeah. Okay. Well, yeah, I think that was the last. But we can hang out. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for staying. We realized that we went over time, but we were really trying to address questions as we went.
Yeah, you guys have been great.
Oh, you should just pull it out. I don't know.
What's that?